again and for like during this wonderful lectures. And I think we're gonna also have seminars after this. And
yes, but unfortunately, today there'll be only talking seminar.
Yeah. Yes.
Because I have some technical problems with the light.
Yeah. I hope you. Yeah. I also worry about it, but.
With the light, not with the health.
Oh, with the light.
Yes, so you see, I found that I cannot use my board because of leaks and all that. So.
Yeah, but anyway, take care. I mean.
Okay.
Yeah. So, anyway, but as we announced, so in any case, we have these lectures and. In the case we have seminars and that requires registration, I understand. And we're gonna.
Yes, but of course there'll be seminars tomorrow.
Okay, yeah. For sure. That's great. And also people are joining, so, but I think we can start.
Okay. So. Okay. So I'll say something preliminary because I think it's important, because recently I was talking to a real physicist who was doing dark matter physics, and I realized how far we are from these people. So this program is a program in mathematical physics. So previously, I thought that there is experimental physics and theoretical physics. Now I changed my mind, and I actually think that there is a subject called mathematical physics. And this mathematical physics. Okay, so how can I move down? Like this. So, in experimental physics, we are checking the world around us. In theoretical physics, we study models that may be seriously considered as candidates for description of the real world. Here, seriously is important. For example, SUSY is considered a piece of theoretical physics because with the SUSY particles, three gauge couplings constants more probably meet together at the long expected grand unification, as we know. However, beautiful unification of electromagnetism and gravity due to Kaluza, people mistakenly call it Kaluza-Klein, not only these were two different people, they lived basically and worked about 20 years from each other. However, people call them Kaluza-Klein. No, it was Kaluza. So it was not considered being theoretical physics because of obvious lack of Kaluza particles. And still, we don't expect them to be there. So this is a piece of mathematical physics. When we study models, we study structures. When we study phenomena, you see, I'm coming to my theme that in mathematical physics, we are studying models. I like this expression, that models of different worlds that look somehow similar to ours. You see, like in geometry, people mostly study objects that looked in some aspect similar to two-dimensional sphere. So maybe you want to think about crazy almost spaces like spectra or something like that. You don't think that they look pretty much like a sphere or arithmetic surfaces, but they have something in common. And also, we have an intrinsic notion of interesting model. You see, in theoretical physics, model is interesting if it is close to experiment, if it solves some experimental puzzle. However, in mathematical physics, we are doing different thing. The model is interesting because it exhibits different phenomena. Like in group theory, when you study group theory, you probably would like to restrict yourself to SU3. So space-time rotations as SU2, maybe Lorentz, maybe SO5. However, one of the most exciting group is E8. And you know how people say? People say that there is no such group in the real world. It's a group that was invented by string theorists. So we are studying not only models with interesting phenomena, we are studying classes of models. It's because the phenomena is a function of a model. So we study things, as people in physics say, in dynamics, as people in mathematics say, in families. Okay, so at the moment, the best model that has interesting phenomena is, of course, string gap theory. Now, honestly speaking, this model is still incomplete and mysterious. So people claim many times that they understood it, but of course, it was not correct. Say nothing about M theory. The superstring perturbation theory is in the bad shape, and foundations are also in the bad shape. And people on string meetings are coming together and trying to find new approaches. So, yes, of course, new approaches are welcome. How can we get understanding without new approach? So this program is a kind of a new approach. So, B theory. So probably you read the introduction letter explaining what B stands for. So B stands for B model and for Birkhovitz simultaneously. So of course, Witten invented B model, but he has different name. So he doesn't fit into the name. So it's B for B model or Birkhovitz. And I honestly think that since we are coming to the same world in B models, we are coming to supersymmetric world. It is possible to see full-fledged string amplitudes in Birkhovitz approach. We can see pretty well super young Mills, and it may be very promising approach, especially if we consider what I call low energy amplitudes. So physicists or string theorists say, let us take alpha prime to infinity. What we will see? We will see something, for sure. And we do see something. And this probably could be described by B strings. So, of course, it'll be a question how to incorporate alpha prime. However, do we really need it? It's also a question. Okay. Still, it could be an interesting model. So, understanding Birkhovitz string as topological string and B string and B model related to supersymmetry. Now people are working towards this direction, and we will also try to keep with Joneses and do something here. At least we will understand the status, and we will probably put some open questions. Okay, so what I'm going to discuss today. So as I wrote, all that started when Witten introduced A and B topological strings. And in a paper, Sharon Simons is a string theory. He briefly outlined that probably we should develop not the string theories we used to study, but some kind of universal string theory. And the theories are just realizations. So Berkowitz provided some unexpected realization. There are A and B models. There is superstrings. So we need to study universal theory, as Witten recommended. So the problem is, of course, in naming. So universal theory, I am calling higher TQFT. I would call it TQFT. Would this name be occupied by other things? So there is Lurier and company who are classifying TQFT. But the TQFT is a theory not of the kind that includes topological strings. So we need another name. And here there is RH, maybe for higher, maybe for homotopy, but this should be called somehow. And it's not only about strings. It's very general phenomena. So I write, it has avatars in all dimensions and can be applied to various problems. So here we will do 1 and 2. I am not sure about 3, but it's because of my ignorance. And there is 4-dimensional stuff. Of course, in 4 dimensions, we have topological, so-called topological Young-Mills that should be coupled to some kind of topological gravity. It's, of course, a story of this type. So we will start with application in 1 dimension and then go to dimension 2. And then we'll go all over along the program. And I want to make another remark. I actually want questions and comments, because my impression on the subject that I am probably correct in like from 80 to 90% of material. So approximately I'm wrong in 15% of material. So I want to close this gap. By the way, since I hope that I'm right in 85% of material, maybe these discussions would be useful for you too. So that's how we should probably go. Okay, so after these preliminary words, may I ask for questions? Remarks?
Not yet.
Okay, so I understand that now it's not a good time for philosophy. Okay, so let us go to constructions. And then there will be philosophy, not about philosophy, but philosophy about constructions. Okay. So, I need to switch my... I need to go somewhere here. But the very beginning. So here I'll start this Dirac-Siegel QFT and hierarchy QFT. And I will not be in a hurry. I'll try to explain everything. I'm not writing everything, but I'll try to explain everything that I know. So it's a title. And here I put these two guys, whom you definitely know. So it's Dirac and Siegel. And they defined QFT.
Andre. Hi.
Yes.
It seems we cannot see your screen.
You cannot see my screen.
I mean, you didn't switch. You didn't switch the window you're showing. Demonstration.
You have to share another window, I think. Yeah.
Okay. Yes. So how I'm switching this window? I never switched before.
Can just stop the demonstration and start it again. It will work.
Okay. So how to stop the demonstration? It goes this way.
Yeah, just stop. Yes.
So I stopped it. Then when I started, to ask me again.
You open another window and share the screen with that
one. Okay, do you see something?
Yeah, it's great.
Excellent.
Okay, thank you. So you can see these two great guys. First is Dirac, who was so great to rethink the full area of physics, completely killed. So he actually completely killed classical understanding of nature. So he is great. And then interesting things happened. With the definition, I'll comment on it later. But final person is Graham Siegel, who once again shows that if you are formally a mathematician, it doesn't mean that you cannot give definition. To QFT. Okay. So, let us discuss this definition. So, QFT is a symmetric monoidal functor between category of cobordisms equipped with geometric data. And you see, geometric data, it's what I put in red, because I think it's quite important. And category of vector spaces. So, let us first study the definition. And then let's go and play with geometric data.
It was Dirac? No?
Yes. You will see that it was Dirac in a particular case, of course. It was Dirac. So there are different people who involved in the process. Maybe not actually Whiteman, but Atiyah, was very close, but Atiya gave another definition. So the definition of Atiya did not fit Dirac. And while definition of Siegel fit Dirac. So if we start with Dirac, we end up with Siegel. And what's interesting is that during his talks, Siegel never mentioned one-dimensional example for the beginning, but later he started. So still, here an important role was played by Michael Atiya. So you can see him. And people often mix these things. Michael Atiya is not generalization of Dirac, while Siegel is. And I will formulate my version of higher TQFT in Dirac's Siegel spirit. So we are the direct line, linea parte. Okay, so if it's a symmetric monoidal functor, first of all, there should be objects. An object is oriented manifold X that goes to vector space V of X. And here, I know this definition. However, I think here a definition could be modified, but I don't know how. But with oriented, it works okay. Actually, because when you have theory in physics, you rarely take care about orientation. But still. Now, there is a product. So this joint union of manifolds that are objects with the tensor product, they are boundaries for physicists, comes to the tensor product of vector spaces. And now, interesting thing happens, there is a morphism, of course. So morphism is cobordism. And what is important is that this cobordism, what's important for me? Okay, so cobordism comes to the tensor algebra operation. So what's important for me, for Dirac and for Siegel, and that's what's not important for Sir Michael Atiya, is this geometric data. So sometimes Siegel says that this geometric data is metric. In some other versions, it could be just complex structure. But I'm pretty sure that you can put a lot of things as geometrical data. So basically, what is geometrical data? Geometrical data is some field, I would say, that goes into two parts when you cut the manifold. Something that defined locally. Let me also comment on geometrical data here. When we have geometry like metric or complex structure, we have diffeomorphisms. So probably the geometrical data should be considered not as a manifold, but as a supermanifold, actually as a Q-manifold, like metric and diffeomorphisms together. Okay.
Excuse me, I have a question.
Yes.
When you say they're considered up to diffeomorphism, do you mean like up to diffeomorphisms which are homotopy equivalent which are homotopic to identity, or just any mapping class group, any element in the mapping class group?
It's a good question. I would say that all options are possible, and I don't know what is the best one. Because, you know, when I'm speaking about supermanifold of metric up to diffeomorphisms, when I call it supermanifold, I'm acting as an engineer from the Lurie presentation, who says that Q-manifolds are for engineers, and educated people should use his science. But you see, mapping class group, it's something that engineer is missing. Maybe things would be even more complicated. But look, this is in any kind of a scheme. That's how it should look like, and this thing should be refined. You see? So my point of view is that Dirac-Siegel axioms is a very good step in the proper direction. However, the stuff would be developed. So you may ask about the scalar product on the vector space. Interesting question. Sometimes it seems that sometimes there is scalar product, sometimes there is not, and I don't know how to answer. Should it be always a scalar product, or just theories of two kinds, with a scalar product or without a scalar product? Still, I expected that this would be kind of pedagogical talk, so I put these pictures, actually two pictures. If you think what does it mean to be a functor, you will see this. One second, please. But by the way, I think that most interesting here is not just set of axioms, but representations. So here are axioms, and what I like examples. So here I have the one-dimensional example, or when dimension of the boundary is zero. And with a very nice geometric data, length of the interval. So we have nice object that I call I. You know why I call it I? Because I want to keep trace of fibon. So I is a proper replacement of fibon functional integral. So it's just a function, operator valid function. People used to call it an evolution operator. So if we cut, we have this cut interval into two intervals. Have this rule. From this, we have this nice exponent. And that's it. This is quantum mechanics up to unitarity. So, Kolya, I'm trying to explain to you why, that it was Dirac, somehow, who formulated things this way. And it was, and now I'm coming to almost this way. At least von Neumann attributed it to Dirac. So he was closer. So he knew better. That's why I put these two guys together on the following slide. So, of course, it's a question that in conventional quantum mechanics, Hamiltonian is Hermitian. However, it doesn't so important if we work in so-called Euclidean quantum mechanics. There is no need to have new unitarity there. After all, it's a mathematical structure. And it's just, okay, rotation or exponent. The thing you have is exponent. But what is the most remarkable here is what I put in bold. We do not need Planck constant fundamental formulation of quantum mechanics. And you see, there is a person who disagrees. And this person who disagrees is great Mr. Feynman. Because he spent some effort putting this constant back into physics. So this was the branching point. Either you follow von Neumann and Dirac, or you follow Feynman. So you see how great Feynman is. But now when we follow Siegel, you may appreciate that while I respect Feynman a lot, I sometimes call him great reactionary because he moved everybody back. And these issues about Planck constant, where it comes, what does it mean, is it really there? I think it's a good topic for complementary talk. But we will do it alongside with the main program. And here is my problem. So I definitely know that it's only interval that you can cut only in one way, into two intervals. I am aware of that if you have a disk, you can cut it like this and have manifolds with angles. And what I know is that Luria spent a lot of time explaining how to work with manifolds with angles. However, he is working without geometrical data. I want to understand things with geometrical data. And I don't know where to look for. So I say help. If somebody could help me how to write it down with angles so we can get good models in two dimensions, it would be great. By the way, before we go to another slide, I want to say about these axioms. Actually, if you look at what's called rational conformal field theories or theories with chiral algebra, you could easily find these axioms explicitly. And if somebody is interested in these old activities of end of 80s, I can explain, because it is really there. Moreover, people say about demodules, cobordisms as demodules. No, actually, in some cases, they are not demodules. They're just explicit functions. So I can explain it too for somebody who may be interested in it. So when I was doing this, I never heard about monoidal categories. But still, and even I think Greg Moore never heard about it these days. And it's a pity that Siegel is not writing texts. He is going and talking, and it's not clear what he thinks at the moment. Okay. Goodbye, Mr.
I think they now joined forces with Kansevich and writing something.
Ah, okay. So it'll be like binary guess. It'll kill everybody. Good. Good. So, by the way, Siegel, he's talking, missed one-dimensional case for some time. I don't know why. Okay. Now we come to the question of observables. You see, I am not talking about fields. Of course, in what's striking? That in Siegel formulation of quantum field theory, you not only you have no Planck constant, you don't have fields at all. Okay. But if there are no fields, maybe there could be local observables. And they'll say sometimes there are. So I realize that there is some confusion in the literature. Recently, my student showed me the paragraph from the book of factorization algebras in quantum field theory by Kevin Costello and Owen Gwilliam. And they refer to Siegel that he gives a definition of local observable that I think is not quite correct. So somewhere information is missed, is lost. At least from Siegel to me. So I'll give my own definition. And it goes as follows. It starts like Siegel definition, that in order to have a local observable, you cut a ball. So when you cut a ball, you have additional boundary component or additional object. And then you can put there a vector, since there is a vector space. However, what Castell and Gwilliam are writing is that you just need to take R to zero. So what I propose is a bit different. You are not taking R to zero. You first consider a family of vectors that belong to the boundary, contract it, and only then you take R to zero. So ball together with a family of vectors. So this family may look divergent, however you don't have natural topology. But the only interesting thing is a limit. So I propose that if there is a limit, this limit is local observable. Actually, there are some families of vectors that do not have limit. We don't consider them. There are family that have limit. These are interesting. And there are families that have the same limit. So we do not distinguish between them. So it's kind of interesting stuff. Why I'm considering this stuff interesting? Because actually it's related to anomalous dimensions of operators. Because anytime you perturb quantum field theory, you have to redo this procedure. It's interesting. So procedure of finding local operators, I think it's quite interesting. It's, for me, it's similar to procedure of finding the tangent space to the manifold, say, described by equations. Okay, I can also add something here. So observable does not need to be a point. It could be a line. Let me pretend that I'm a physicist. At least I know something. I know some physicists. I heard something about them. So they used to study line observables. So there should be a definition for a line observable. So here's my proposal. Take a line or a graph or any figure, take a tubular neighborhood, cut it out, have a boundary, take a family of vectors, contract, and get the observable. Of course, so in this way, you can have a Wilson line observable without having fields, of course.
So
you don't need to have fields.
Andrei, excuse me, I do not really understand the definition. Could you please elaborate? This tubular neighborhood, is it fixed? Or a ball, is it fixed? Or
no, so a ball had a parameter R.
But written. I mean, you will obtain the different vector space for each for each sure, value of the radius.
Sure, of course.
And they are so not related in any way.
Of course, they are not related in any way. There is no connection. But you have this family of balls and family of vectors.
I mean, what are these vectors?
It is a piece of a definition. Suppose for each ball you have a vector, such that.
A vector in the space I of.
It's the space associated to the sphere.
Okay.
That is.
Yeah, sure.
It's a vector. So what's interesting is that if you play with the examples, so it's not the topic of this talk, you will see how interesting it could work.
But I mean, you could just have like any family of these vectors, and you will obtain a lot of
if you have a family of these vectors, you will not have a limit. So if you just have a family, so general family doesn't have a limit. So it's called the bad family. We are not dealing with people from bad families. So there are good families. Good families are such that they have a limit. And it's interesting that there are many good families. So in order to see this, it's better to go to make conformal transformation, and then you have a long tube. So you have a long tube, and you have a propagator that is exponent of t times L naught plus L naught bar. Okay. So if you take you may stupidly identify vectors, but mostly you will get a zero limit. So it's not a way how to do it. The proper way how to do it is to multiply the vector by e to the minus t expected conformal dimension. And in this case, you will get exactly the conformal observable local of proper dimension. You can actually play with it in free conformal field theories. And also you can play with it if you think that you solved this problem in non-perturbed theory and then perturb it. So whenever you perturb your theory, you immediately have to rethink what the local observables are. it's a subtle question, because would you be somebody like Feynman in some sense? You would say that local observable is a function of local fields. Why you need to do anything when you perturb a theory? Function of local fields is a function of local fields. However, since there are no fields, this definition has no meaning. So what I try to give is a proper definition. And this, and what is important is that this definition comes to this Wilson line. Because you can write down what Wilson line is in terms of fields. By the way, not only there are no necessarily, not only quantum field theory may have no fields, okay? When it has fields, say like in four-dimensional super Young Mills, there are dualities. And you need to have a nice definition, nice and variant definition. So here is a definition. Wilson line or Tjoft line without fields. Okay, but it's also an interesting topic to discuss as a complementary session. But here, I just wanted to say that dimension one, the ball is an interval, the sphere are two points, and that's why observables, local observables, are elements of endomorphisms of V, because zero-dimensional sphere has two components. That's why you get endomorphism of V. So local observables in quantum mechanics are operators. So we are 10 minutes after the break. Now let's make a break here, okay? Or we can continue.
It's up to you, so.
No, it's up to organizer.
Okay, let's wait, make a, like say, like 2 or 3 minutes break for probably some questions.
Okay.
Like,
Maybe you prefer to ask questions.
Yeah, probably that's a good time to stop for questions and otherwise.
Because you see, in my plan, okay. So maybe we'll do this way. Let us make a 2 minutes break. And then we start questions.
Okay.